that time, we are not just ourselves.
Mm.
And we are not just who we think we are. Because our mind and our being is infinite. When we have composure in our practice, we are the entire world and we are Buddha. You know, in the legend of the Buddha, the story of Buddha, after he left home and practiced many different ways for many years, and finally sat under the tree for many hours, and he had an insight, and it is reported to us in history that he said, everything has Buddha nature. Which means everything is Buddha. And when we first hear that, we say, what do you mean? What are you talking about? That kind of idea is so far beyond anything we ever imagined in our ordinary life. We are, everything is, everything has Buddha nature. But we start to understand this point after we have this practice for a time. We start to have some feeling about it. So we say that when we sit with determination, when we sit with sincerity, we are ordinary and we are Buddha. It's a concept, some kind of idea. We are ordinary and Buddha. What does it mean? What it means is that our ordinary mind is not bothered by something that appears in it. The mind, our ordinary mind, is not disturbed by something that arises, and also it doesn't grasp for something that arises. It simply isn't bothered by anything that arises in the mind, in the ordinary mind. So we are ordinary and we are Buddha. But before we start to practice, before we have our practice, we human beings, we cling to the idea of me. This is very usual, this is normal, and this is where all the trouble starts. We cling to the notion of me or myself, and this is our ordinary side. Me, the ordinary side. The side that forgets about interdependence and its close relationship with all things. But when we have our practice, we are both. We are ordinary and we are Buddha. So when we sit, when we come to sit with some sincerity, we are not the same being as we were before we came to sit. We're not the same. And when we have, when we live our lives as practice, we are not the same as when we did not have practice. So, of course, many people will ask, what do you mean? How is it possible to be ordinary and Buddha? How is it possible to be ordinary and holy at the same time? How is this possible? And it's, of course, a very natural question, because as a concept, it makes no sense. But the question comes about when we see with only one eye, when we see our life and we see the world from one standpoint, one narrow standpoint. So our practice is about letting go or giving up seeing with a narrow viewpoint, to see things very broadly, to see things with no barriers, to see things without, to see things not from a conditioned viewpoint. This is our practice. So when we can let go or give up seeing with a very narrow viewpoint, then our mind's eye expands. We say mind's eye, we don't know what it is exactly, but we see things more broadly. The mind's eye expands, and we can understand things more readily, with less confusion. And when we let go of seeing with a narrow conditioned viewpoint, we start to become aware of things that were previously unseen and that were forgotten. And we are less disturbed by what happens. And we are less disturbed by an image of ourselves. We are less concerned about me and myself. So so when you are in some relation in everyday life, and somebody says to you, oh, you know, you just, you're mediocre, you're a fool. You don't know anything, you're a jerk, and you're not disturbed, and you simply say, oh yeah, yes, I'm mediocre, and you're not disturbed. Or if somebody says, wow, you're really good, you're a Buddha, you're wonderful, and you say, okay, Buddha, your mind is not disturbed or excited by whatever enters. Okay, is that so? This is composure. How does it happen that we are Buddha and ordinary at the same time? It doesn't matter how it happens. After we practice for a time, we come to understand that Buddha is no more special than an ordinary person. Although we attribute many wonderful qualities to Buddha, fundamentally Buddha is not more special than an ordinary person. And the ordinary person is not any different than Buddha. This is the way to understand ourselves completely. And if we practice with this understanding or with this trust, we will not be bothered by anything that happens. Whatever we see or hear will be okay. But before we have this feeling, we have to put practice in our life. We have to adjust our life to practice. Because we may accept and appreciate this idea intellectually, ordinary and Buddha, no difference. Maybe we accept it intellectually, but without the feeling of it, the understanding has no depth. So this is why we just simply continue to practice, to have a feeling for this truth, that Buddha discovered through his effort. Oh, look, everyone has Buddha nature. If we continue our practice, we too will have this understanding. The understanding and the feeling that you are Buddha and ordinary person at the same time. Although we may be able to explain Buddhism intellectually, if we don't have a feeling of it, we can't say we are Buddhist. Even though we read all the scriptures and the sutras and we understand the principles, if we don't have a feeling for it, we really can't say we're Buddhist. It's only when our personality is marked, when our personality is characterized by this feeling, then we are Buddhist. And then even though we do some ordinary activity, it is Buddha's activity. And it's also our personal activity. There's no difference. Strictly speaking, we really can't say, I am doing something, I do something, because no one of us is truly separate from others. We are interdependent. So when you speak, when you say something, there is some sound. Something that you hear and something that others hear. Others hear you when you speak. And when I speak now, you hear this voice. It means we are interdependent. It's a limited viewpoint. It's a narrow viewpoint for me to say, I speak. Because I can't do it alone. I cannot do anything exclusively by myself. I cannot do something exclusive of everyone else. So actually, we really can't say, I am doing something. I am doing it. So if someone does something, everyone is doing it. This is interdependence. And there is no explanation. But at the same time, we also cannot say, oh, this is Buddha's activity, because you yourself are doing it. You yourself, with your body and mind, are doing the speaking. So we can't say, oh no, this is Buddha's activity. Before we say something or do something, that activity already exists here. And that's who we are, Buddha and each of us as an individual. So our human activity is both personal and it's universal, a cosmic. And there's no explanation. Realize that we have been giving all of our attention to who we are not. We've been paying all this attention to who we are not, and we have been ignoring who we really are. And we continue doing it because we feel a little bit uneasy about the reality. We feel a little bit uncomfortable about interdependence, emptiness, impermanence. Those go against our habits, and so we don't take them seriously. And we look for satisfaction in what is not real. Like we chanted tonight, it's all empty. All the aggregates that go to make up a human being, we chant, all empty, not real. But we find satisfaction in what is not real because we have this notion that we are, each of us, I am the center of the universe. Wherever I go, there's something important there that I carry around with me. It's like Dogen said, we attach to something not real and we ignore what is real. And this is what most people do. This is where all the difficulties start. But if we start to become aware of how we are, of how we have been, of how we have been understanding the world, and how we have been behaving. And when we become aware of how we have been seeing ourselves, in other words, if we start to recognize our delusions, then we start to remember who we are. And we start to find composure and trust in ourselves, because we start to see ourselves a little differently. And this trust that arises in us, this trust that develops, is not the usual kind. The usual kind of trust is a belief in something that seems so real, but which is not. We have that kind of trust all the time. But the trust we find in our practice is a bit different than that. So when we can sit without attachment to the mood, or some sound, and when we can sit with open and ready mind, this is pure practice. And right there is the freedom. Freedom from all the things that have been disturbing us in our life. So, ordinary life, our life exists just now, just in this moment. The only time we exist is now. Just now. But yet, each present moment includes its past and future. This is part of what is meant in the Buddhism about dependent origination. Everything exists because of some past condition, past cause. So the present includes its past, and also includes its future, because our present is the cause and condition for what's next. Each moment, each present moment includes its past and its future. So we have our momentary life and we have eternal life. This is how we should understand our everyday life. But this moment, this activity, this feeling right now is not independent. It is not a standalone. It is interdependent. When you have this understanding, there is freedom. And the mind is infinite. And that's the best way for us to really appreciate our life. And who we are.